beautiful out this morning?
Gorgeous.
Yes.
Anybody got their trees blown down last night?
Nope.
Did ya?
No.
Scary though, huh? Yeah, that wind just come up and that rain come across there like sheets of snow, and I mean to tell you. But anyway, just thankful we're all here. I see we have a little change in our bulletin this morning. Our birthdays and anniversaries are up first. Who has a birthday this week? Besides Diane Rogers and Betty Lover. Amanda? Amanda? And Lisa? All right. Happy birthday. Tomorrow, Diana, for those boxes. Janet.
The bulletin says Wednesday.
It says Christmas boxes need to be turned in today. November 9th.
But it's under Wednesday.
It's under Wednesday. November 9th, no, it's tomorrow. It is tomorrow at 9:30, Monday.
It's under upcoming events.
Today's on Sunday.
Under Wednesday.
Well, the 8th is Tuesday, Wednesday's the 9th, they have their...
We're going to do it tomorrow morning. There's just been a typical, no, a typical. That's okay. We gotta straighten around though. Cross that out in your bulletin. We're going to meet tomorrow morning at 9:30 here at the church.
Load them in my car.
Tomorrow, and we're gonna load them in Diana's car. That's right.
Kathleen?
Yes.
We'll also pick up food at Michigan Food Bank tomorrow, so we'll be back here probably 10:30, quarter to 11, we'll need help with that.
Okay, are you gonna put it on the phone?
I don't know, I'll share my... We can call Bob and have him do that.
Okay.
That's an FYI, because if tomorrow you're doing your boxes, we're gonna be from...
We'll be here anyway, probably.
Oh, that's fine.
Oh, okay.
Not a problem. We'll work around each other, that's teamwork.
Yeah, there you go.
That's teamwork. It's about unity, teamwork, T-E-A-A-M, whatever. Start that one over. Tuesday, ladies' Bible study at McDonald's, and we're having a good time there. And it's good to be back there at McDonald's, and the girls just are having, we're all having a fantastic...
Betty made it Tuesday.
Celebration with the Lord, what?
Betty made it Tuesday.
Betty made it Tuesday? Oh, thank you, Betty. That's wonderful.
Good.
Okay, Stronghold is gonna be with us on the 13th.
Next week.
Sunday, you wanna say anything?
We're gonna, Stronghold's gonna be here, and we're gonna have a wonderful time of worship. You won't have to listen to me, and...
I didn't hear any amens.
Hear any amen, you know.
But seriously, we're gonna do that. The thing of it is, we're gonna make a whole day of enjoyment, because she's gonna tell you next that we're gonna, it's our regular potluck. After potluck, we're gonna have a pound auction. Don Bearer is coming to be the auctioneer. We're gonna go pay $30 for a pound of spaghetti and enjoy ourselves. So, next Sunday is a time of joy. While I'm up here, if you'll look on the back of your bulletin, there's an insert. It's called Equip 22. On next Saturday from 9 to 5 at the First Church of God down just south of us here on M-52, they are having a conference that's about equipping people to be able to be a witness. Now, I can't go. I have some other commitments that I have to make. But for those of you, you know, we've been praying that we would be effective in reaching our community and whatever. I would encourage some of you, if the Lord lays on your heart, if you could be there from 9 to 5, you will enjoy the people who are speaking, and I would encourage you to be there. But that's what it's all about. And if you can, Friday or Saturday from 9 to 5, wonderful conference just down the street from us. And the good news is it's free. So.
And will they have something to eat too, probably?
Church says, if you feed them, they will come.
I had the privilege of attending the conference, the Church of God conference with Pastor Friday. And the whole theme of it was unity. And you know, when I say unity, and when you think about unity, there's a whole lot of stuff that comes up in your mind about what unity is. And everybody has a different vocabulary for unity. Think about what unity is to you, and within the church and within our community, to have unity, to work together, to be a team tomorrow. at 9:30, and the food will come in. We'll probably end up helping. You'll carry that stuff in. We're in unity with each other, and it's a peaceful thing. It's a very peaceful thing. And I'll probably be having some highlight notes when I get a chance to put them together from this conference. And I like to go to conferences like this. I like to go and hear different speakers and all that stuff. And I took notes, and so I'm going to put some together and have a little, well, maybe I'll take the pastor's place one Sunday. I don't know.
Promises.
But anyway, we're just, it was a good day, Friday. Okay.
Besides that, she got to eat chocolate-covered strawberries.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. Oh, yes. Yes.
When are we having the turkey dinner?
Turkey dinner?
I was told we was going to do this a potluck.
Oh, okay. She hasn't gotten to it.
Okay.
On November 20th, you know, we have our big doings on the 19th. I have a lot of family coming from out of town, and they're probably going to stay and worship. Well, we had to feed people, and there's no way we could do it at our house. And so Lucy and I talked it over. And what we're going to do is, on Sunday the 20th, any leftovers from the buffet and soup and sandwiches, the whole church is invited, and that's going to be our Thanksgiving dinner for the church. That's what's happening there. Lucy and I will be providing that. And so, y'all come, okay?
Do you want to talk about your party too?
Yeah, you want me to do that?
Sure.
On November 19th, well, actually, November 18th, Lucy and I will have been married 50 years. Now, if you will notice on the screen up there, our wedding was not elegant, but it was memorable. I came home with a case of infectious hepatitis, and I was in isolation. So you can see her resplendent in her bridal gown of an isolation gown, and in her mask and whatever. But we decided then that we were going to celebrate. We had a big celebration on the 25th. And then when the 50th came, we decided we got to do it again. And so we will be celebrating November 19th down at the First Church of God Rec Center. It's the building behind there. Doors will open around 1 o'clock. At 1:15, we will renew our vows. And then following our vow renewal, we're going to be cutting a cake. And then from 2 to 5, we're going to have a Thanksgiving buffet. And you can come and eat and whatever. The gentleman who is going to be officiating in our vow renewal is the pastor that married us.
Oh.
He's flying up from Huntsville, Alabama.
Aww.
And he's 87 years old. And a great guy. He's actually my big brother in Christ, but he was Lucy's pastor at the time. And so that's what we're planning for the day. And now, if you can't make it, Chuck has agreed to help us to stream the vow renewal and things like that. So that's where we are. But our theme is thankful for 50 years.
Amen.
All right. Does that explain what you're looking for?
Yeah, I think so.
And like I say, y'all come. Y'all come.
Let's stand and do our pledges this morning. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one
nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom stands. One Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart, that I might not sin against
God.
Lord, we just come to you and thank you for being able to pray this morning out to you and for caring about us and loving us and to dying on the cross for us. Lord, we just ask that you have brought the, we know that you have brought your Holy Spirit in this sanctuary this morning.
Yes.
Help us to grow in you. And we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. And let's, standing in the need of prayer, let's sing that this morning.
I hear the rolling.
you may be seated. Wow. Let's worship with our tithes and offerings. Will the ushers come forward, please? Oh my goodness, that song.
Yes.
How great thou art. Lisa, would you pray for the offering, please?
Precious Father, we just thank you, praise you, and bless you for this day, and ask that you multiply these tithes and offerings like you did with the fish and the loaves. Mm-hmm. And we just thank you for being able to be here today.
Yes.
We just say, ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Show yourself strong. Please bring the blood pressure down. Father, strengthen her faith. Bring her the joy of the Lord. Father, we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you,
Jesus. Anybody else have praise or concerns? Yes, Missy.
My praise is, I'm going to be a grandma again.
Ooh.
Oh, I'm going to be a sister.
All right. Okay.
And I have a concern. My son has been fighting COVID all week, so I'm going to pray for him. He's going back to work by the Monday, but he's been off all week.
Okay. Let's start from the back there and kind of work up. Yeah. Go ahead.
I have a praise. This morning I looked out and my two granddaughters, Kelly and Lori, were at my home and they came in, they brought me breakfast from McDonald's, and then they did my leaves again. And I was so thankful, because I mean I have a lot of leaves. They ended up getting 7 bags of leaves, and that's the third time that they've been done. So I just praise God for my family that loves me and takes care of me.
Anybody else back there in the back?
I'm just thankful that I was able to go out to Arizona to see my sister, and we had good times and some good talks, and it was really an amazing blessing for me to go.
Anybody else up here? Jim? No.
John.
I'd like prayer for my sister Celia Ferry. She's on a downhill slide and it doesn't look good what's ahead, so I would like some prayer for her.
Is she still at home?
Yes.
Sissy?
Is it Sissy?
Yes.
It is Sissy?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
My mom saw the doctor, the orthopedic doctor on Thursday. Her arm is fractured at the wrist. They really would like to do surgery and put a pin in, but, you know, my mom's been through a lot of surgery lately, and I don't know that that's... So they suggested that casting would work. Probably won't have the same range and motion as she had before, but she doesn't have a lot with her arm and her hand anyway, so we went with a casting right now. So I pray that it heals. It heals beyond what we ever thought it could heal, please. And just keep her in your prayers, please.
Let us stand.
I have a praise. We got quite a surprise phone call yesterday from Charlie's sister's daughter, Sue. They decided they're going to North Carolina, but they stopped through just for a short visit with us, and they even brought us Kentucky Fried Chicken. And so it was just a surprise, but a blessed surprise of that, and we thank God and for safe traveling for them now.
Two that we need to remember especially. First of all, a shirt tail relative of Walter and Kathleen, you probably saw it on the news, was killed on 21 Friday morning. He was a 19-year-old boy. He was a good kid. The family is devastated, and we need to hold them up in prayer. Just a moment. And then second of all, we need to remember Jim Barrower. I don't know how many of you are aware. He has been diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer, stage 2 liver cancer. He's going to be seeing the doctors this week, and they'll be putting together a treatment plan. But I do ask that you keep Jim in our prayers.
I would like prayer for my family. We lost a granddaughter yesterday, an overdose. She was down in Florida.
What's her name? Just first name.
Her name is Leanne.
Leanne? Yes. All right.
Pray for our family.
Yeah. A lot of hurting people this morning.
I guess I'm the slow boat, last one on the front. But anyhow, I don't know what. About 10 days ago, I went up to the hospital. Doctor wanted a sonic cardiogram. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, I sat there to watch him do all this and that. I got to actually watch my heart working. It is there. But anyhow, he reported back to me a couple of days ago, and everything was great.
Thank the Lord. Amen.
Let's sing our chorus, our prayer song this morning.
Lord, what we want is for your name to be honored throughout our mission field here. Father, we want people to experience the joy of the Lord. Father, you also heard our request. Father, here we are, a couple homes where young people have lost their lives. Lord, for those of us that are older, in one sense, it's kind of expected. But when young people lose their lives, and especially for their family and their parents, it's devastating. Father, only you can bring comfort in these things. Father, as these things come from families, most of our families have issues. And we're asking that as these, through these tragedies, will you bring healing to our families? Father, most of our families have some kind of healing that we need. And you said that by your stripes we're healed. Father, we're asking that you would bring healing to our families and to those on our mission field. Father, we pray that you would break the addictions. Father, so many of them are generational curses. Lord, it will take you to do it. Father, you've got to bring the healing. You've got to break it. You've got to bring glory to yourself,
yes,
in order,
yes,
to bring healing and hope,
yes,
in these situations. Father, be with our nation. Lord, Tuesday, we have our election. Lord, you know we're a horribly divided nation right now. And Father, unfortunately, it's almost an assertion of power. Where once we used to vote for civil servants, people who would serve the people, Father, there's a spirit and a move afoot to become lords over God's people. And Father, we're asking that your will would be done in our election.
Amen.
Father, if things don't square with your word, that's not your will. We're asking that you would be with our election process. Father, we're asking that you would put a guard around every ballot box.
Yes.
Father, may it be an honest and upstanding election.
Yes.
Father, we ask that you would be with us. And when we come done, whether our candidate wins or not, Lord, we want us to feel good about the process. Father, be with our president, be with our governor, be with our legislators, our judges, our civil servants. Father, we're asking that that your worldview, not Satan's worldview, the view that man is the center of everything, but that God is the center. Will you allow that worldview to come back and reshape America? Father, there are some things we've lost that we need revival and need to regain, and we're asking in a special way that you would help us to regain one nation under God.
Yes.
Father, as we come before you, we pray that you would be with our community. We're thankful for those who serve. We ask that you would help them to be among the best and wisest among us. Lord God, then we do pray that you'd be with us as a church. First of all, we thank you for the guidance that you've given us. Father, for the way that you're transforming us. For me, it is very exciting to see the transformation that's taking place. But yet, Father, we know we're very early and you want to do some other things with us. Father, we're asking that you would help us to be submissive to your will and your way. And Father, you be the potter. Let us be the clay. Shape us into what you want us to be. Be with the remainder of our service. We're asking in a special way that everything that's said, everything that's sung, everything that's done, may it be to your name's honor and glory. Father, when we conclude, we will give your name the praise. For we've asked it in the name of our resurrected Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
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 You may be seated. Our Proverbs this morning is found in Proverbs 28, and it says, "Evil men do not understand justice. Those who seek the Lord understand it fully. Better a person whose walk is blameless than a rich man whose ways are perverse. He who keeps the law is a discerning son, but the companion of gluttons disgraces his father. He who increases his wealth by exorbitant interest amasses it for another. Who will be kind to the poor?" That's a lot of food for thought. Mm-hmm. Yes. Just for Kids is on right now. And then we're going to have a special song with Janet Brenner. And then our sermon and our communion. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Oh, my. Do you girls practice being pretty? I know I'm prejudiced, but I think we've got some of the most beautiful girls in the world that attend church here. I don't know about you, Tony, but I'm thinking about getting a new shotgun. Oh, you're wonderful girls. Did you know, we haven't sung this song for a while, and I want to sing it because it's part of what you bring us, okay? It says, "I've got the joy, joy, joy down in my heart." All right? I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Want to bring joy to your mom and dad? Want to bring joy to them? Yeah, there's a way to do it. You know, the first step in bringing joy to your mom and dad is to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and to accept Him as your King in your life. And to live for Him, do what He says to do. The second thing, have you girls among your school friends, some kids that not about books, but they're just dumb. They do dumb things, right? And they create messes. And everybody has problems with them, and they're dumb. But you want to make your mom and dad happy? You be wise. You watch the way you spend your money. Be wise. You be careful who you make as friends. And you go to good places. Be wise. The scripture says that a child who is wise brings great joy to their parents. And so today, our story is, bring joy to your parents. Amen? Amen. All right. Well, now remember, God loves you, and Jesus loves you. Believe me, this church loves you, and so do I. Amen? Sister Janice, right there, take him to Children's Church.
Thank you.
Amen. Yep.
That's right.
We have hope in the Lord, because he's almighty, and he can work.
That's correct. We have been reflecting on the fundamentals of our faith. As a foundation, we've been talking about breaking up our fallow ground, which the picture is for us to become sensitive to God and the things of God. Things that, you know, as we live and life goes on and whatever, it tends to get, we tend to get a little hard and sensitive, and to redo that. It's a process that the Scripture teaches us we need to do. We want to do this, but first of all, we want to be better Christians. I don't know about you, but I want to be one of the best Christians that ever lived, right?
Amen.
Come on, we want to be good Christians. We also want our life witness to be uncompromised. Remember, before we ever say anything, we need to be the message, and then before we speak the message. St. Francis of Assisi said, "Preach everywhere you go. If necessary, use words." Amen? So we want our life witness to be uncompromised. We want to live in a way that people can see Christ. And then finally, if we do the fundamentals well and our life witness is uncompromised, then our public witness, when we begin to tell what Jesus has done for us, it becomes more effective because our life backs up our words. Now, having said that, we've dealt with several things, but today, as one of the fundamentals of our faith, want to deal with the idea of true and false conversion. You say, well, we don't often talk about this as a fundamental, but the truth of the matter is that it is. This topic actually got highlighted for me years ago when I was studying the Baptist doctrine of once you're saved, all you're always saved. And I struggled with that coming from a holiness background. What people, you could lose your salvation. We called it eternal insecurity, you know. But you could lose your salvation. However, the Baptists believed that when somebody had been living for Christ, been active in the church, walked away from it, their comment was they were never saved in the first place. Now, I had to think about that a little bit, and as I began to study, I began to realize that I still believe and know that the Scripture teaches us that we can lose our salvation. Hebrews 6 is too plain to be misunderstood along those lines. However, as I did my study and I began to look at how God reclaims the backslider, I had watched how people who were saved as children or saved as teenagers and walked away from God and often went out into deep sin, God had a way of drawing them back. And the Scripture teaches us that he reclaims the backslider. And I began to realize, especially in light of Hebrews 6, that Yes, you can lose your salvation, but you almost have to work at it to do it. You see, salvation is a choice we make, right? God opens a door. We have a choice. Now, if you can choose to serve Jesus, you can choose to walk away. That just makes sense, right?
Yep.
Right.
Okay, so you can do that. But the idea that they never had it, we talked about it's rare, and let's go, no more. However, Jesus' teachings and the examples in Scripture show that, as a general rule, most who walk away from the faith were never truly converted. Okay? Let's pick up an example from Scripture. The man's name is Simon Magnus, and he is a magician in Samaria. And now, for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great, and all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, "This man is the divine power known as the Great Power." And they followed him because he had amazed them for a long time with his magic. But when they believed Philip as he preached the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized. He followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles that he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. And when they arrived, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come upon any of them. They simply had been baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. And then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, "Give me also this ability, so that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." Peter answered, "May your money perish with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry, because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord. Perhaps he will forgive you for having such a thought in your heart, for I see you're full of bitterness and captive to sin." Then Simon answered, "Pray to the Lord for me so that nothing you have said may happen to me." Now, let me just say this. There are stories, a number of legends surrounding Simon Magnus. And if you go on Wikipedia or some of the places and look, you can read them. The problem is, it's hard, they're almost fables. And we just kind of need to stick with the Word of God on what we have and what's going on. Because Scripture doesn't say anything more about him than what we know. Now, what we need to realize is that Simon's powers were demonic. The Scripture says he practiced sorcery. Now, the sorcery is a type of magic in which spirits, especially evil ones, are used to make things happen. That's why you don't mess with Ouija boards. You don't mess with science, seances. You don't mess with psychics. Those people are working through evil spirits. What they have is evil. It is strictly forbidden in Scripture. Okay? Well, it says He was, his powers were demonic. Furthermore, he boasted that he was someone great. Right? Why, I can do this. I can do that. I can do lots of things. You know what I mean? And he boasted that he was somebody great. Now, I was young and now I'm old. But you show me someone that boasts a lot, and I'll show you someone that's probably full of hot air. I see heads nodding all over the congregation. He boasted that he was someone great. However, he backed it up. He had amazed the people, high and low. For a long time, he had done some amazing things. And such that the people, I thought when I read this, especially early in my Christian experience, I thought he was just a con man. You know, and they talked about his magic. And I thought that what they were talking about was doing sleight of hand all the time, like the magicians do today, you know? And, you know, how do you saw a woman in half and detach your finger and put it on and doing things like that? It was all sleight of hand. But he was not just a con man. The people had been around long enough, they'd seen enough to know he wasn't just trying to trick him. They said, this man is the divine power, known as the great power. Wow. Okay? So we've got an evil influence that's happening with the people. However, following the persecution in Jerusalem, Philip went to Samaria, and he preached the gospel, the good news of the kingdom, and the good news of Jesus Christ. And in the preaching, the people believed. It was exciting to them to hear about a Savior and a Savior's kingdom. And it was also accompanied by a number of signs and wonders. Evil spirits were exorcised. They cast out demons. Paralytics and cripples were healed. Things happened. And the result of all that was the people that heard, the people heard the message, they saw the miraculous signs, and there was great joy in the city. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine the families where these people were held captive by demons, and all of the problems that it creates in families to have those demons cast out and bring peace to their family? Do you think they had joy? You bet. How about the child that was injured and was paralyzed, and all of a sudden he was healed and able to run and play again? Do you think there was joy? You bet there was joy. This was something that was wonderful. And because of that, there was great joy in the city. Talk about citywide revival. And people were happy. Amen. I got to do a rabbit trail here. I wonder what kind of joy people are going to experience in our city when God begins to break the powers of addiction, when God begins to heal the wounded hearts that have been wounded by abuse. What's going to happen? What kind of joy are we going to have around here where people are healed and set free? We're already seeing some people healed. We're doing that. Now we're not going to have a healing campaign, and we're not going to advertise it. That's going to be God's problem, not ours, right? Right. But we're sure going to thank Him when He does. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Great joy because of the gospel and the gift of God. Now, Philip's miracles were of a higher quality than Simon's. First of all, they were genuine. So you never know about what the devil does. They were genuine. Second of all, they benefited the people. Think about that. Simon did them so that he could be somebody great. God's gift was the people so that they could enjoy the gift of God. And finally, it was a gift from God, and it didn't cost them a thing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Having said that, Simon believed and was baptized. But he believed not because of love and that his heart was changed, but the display of power. Okay? Then what he did, he exposed himself by offering to purchase the gift of the laying on of hands. We find out what his real heart was. He wanted to be somebody great. He wanted to be known as the great power. And while these guys were doing this and they had a higher quality power than his, he wanted to have it for himself. And he showed, trying to purchase it. And so what happened was, Peter observed, number one, his heart was not right before God. Now, he believed that Jesus came, but it was a belief in a historical Jesus. It wasn't something that transformed him. And furthermore, his heart was such that it was wrong. And Peter observes, your heart's not right before God. Okay, he believed, he was baptized, he was associating with the group, but his heart wasn't right. Okay? He was not a new creation. He just changed crowns. He really wasn't converted. Furthermore, Peter says, you are filled with bitterness and envy. That doesn't sound like the same person to me, does it, you? But he was filled with bitterness and envy. You see, he'd been bested by a greater power. He lost his influence and position. And it probably really hurt his income. And he was bitter. And he was envious. What's interesting to me, and I missed this until I studied it this time for this sermon. Peter told him to repent and pray to the Lord so that he could perhaps be forgiven. Right? But his response was, pray for me so that none of these things will happen to me. He had no intention of repenting. And he was unwilling to go to God for himself. Wow. Okay. So he fooled him for a while, but he didn't fool him forever. I found this comment in one of my commentaries. I really like it. Whenever and wherever God is at work among people, there are not only genuine responses, but also counterfeit ones. Amen. Well, let's see what Jesus has to say about this, okay? Matthew 7, 21 through 27. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. These people assumed they were Christians. Right? Well, they were doing great things. But they based their assumptions on works that they'd done. Oh, we preached the gospel, a lot of miracles. We did some great things for you, Jesus. That sounds like Simon, doesn't it? You're going to have to back it up. Okay, go. No, keep, go forward. Go forward. I got them backwards.
Oh, I was trying to figure out. Yeah. I was thinking, well, I've already went there. Yeah, come back.
Okay, now just go back one.
That's it.
Nope. Okay, go forward. Go forward. Thank you. Jesus says to them, what? Depart from me. I never knew you. Oh, but these people hung around the church for years. They've done great things. They served. They were on the board of deacons. They did the work. They gave money. They tithed. They did everything, right? I never knew you. Reminds me of a story. Cowboy was in town, and he went to a church. And when he got to the church, the people that were, he was, of course, was dressed like a cowboy, flannel shirt, jeans, boots, and had a pretty worn Bible under his arm. And the preacher preached, and as they were leaving, all the people there were dressed up in suits, ties, and the ladies were dressed to the nines and whatever. And so as he's coming to the door, the pastor shakes his hand and he says, listen, I want you to go home this week and see if you are dressed properly to come to church here. All right, I will. So he comes back the next week and he is dressed exactly the same way. The preacher looked at him and said, I thought I told you to go home and ask the Lord if that is proper attire for this church. And the preacher said, I did. He said, well, what did the Lord say? The Lord said he didn't know. He'd never been there. We laugh. But this is eternal. Amen. That we can be having church, claiming to be church people, doing churchy things. And Jesus said, I don't know you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Next one. You see, they were self-deceived. What they believed and what the truth was something different. Next verse. He called them evildoers. You imagine that? How does it scare you that you could get up to the judgment bar and Jesus say, I never knew you? Doesn't that scare you a little bit? What's even more scary about that is Jesus said, many will say in that day. Many. Unfortunately, this is more common than we realize. I don't know about you, but I know about me. You take every one of those things that those people did in Jesus' name, and I would claim them. It scares the life out of me. And I want to make sure that I am doing them genuinely, having genuine things, right?
Yeah.
I want Jesus to come when I come and say, welcome home. Well done. That's what I'm looking for. But I don't want to deceive myself. Could you?
Yes.
Back, please.
Yes.
Go ahead. Next. Oh, okay. Next one. What this means and what Scripture actually calls for is for us to periodically take time where we get before the Lord and do some deep self-examination. For example, it is wise to pray Psalm 139, 23 and 24. Search me, O God, and seek my heart, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. Right?
Yes.
Search me, God.
Yes.
Because I'm human. And as a human, I tend to be self-centered, and I tend to self-deceive. But please, shine the light of truth on my life and let me know from you. And if you see something that's wicked in there, cleanse me. Amen. I don't want to get to the judgment bar and you say to me, depart from me, I never knew you. God, please search me.
Yes, Lord, do it. Do it.
So we begin to ask ourselves questions like, is our heart right? That was the problem with Simon. His heart wasn't right. Are we doing the right things for the right reasons? You see, motive carries everything. And why we do what we do is far more important than what we do.
Amen.
Amen.
Want me to keep going?
Yep. Do we act out of love or quid pro quo? I put that in there to get your attention. What's quid pro quo? You give me something and I give you back. And too many people, they want to serve God for the benefits. And Jesus, I'll do this if you'll do that. Quid pro quo. Okay? Sounds like a politician, doesn't it? Huh? Do we act out of love? Or are we trying to do some kind of barter here? Do we base our salvation on our works or on our trust in Christ? Now, I'm not saying works are unimportant. That's not what I mean. But what we are tempted to do is to take our works and say, well, of course I know I'm saved. Look how I give to the poor. Of course I'm saved. Look how nice I am to even my enemies. Of course I'm saved. And we work through that. We base our salvation on that. When the true answer is, how do you know you're saved? I was a sinner, and I deserved to go to hell. But Jesus Christ died on a cross and rose from the dead so that it would be right and fair for God to forgive me.
Yes, yes.
Nothing I do, it's forgiveness. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness has nothing to do with justice in that sense. He said, it's never going to be remembered against you again. And I'm going to tell you something. What we have as Christians are those good works come out of love and thankfulness for the fact that he died for our sins.
Yes,
and we don't have to suffer.
Yes. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
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 Let's talk about the characteristics of true conversion. Submission to the will of God, confession, repentance, belief in Jesus Christ. Well, that'd make a good sermon series, wouldn't it? Huh? 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 11. What does Peter say about that? Go ahead, this is going to go quick. Add to your faith, virtue. Add to your virtue, knowledge. Add to your knowledge, self-control. Add to your self-control, perseverance. Add to your perseverance, godliness. Add to your godliness, brotherly kindness. And add to your brotherly kindness, love. He said, if you do these things and they abound in you, you will be fruitful in your work. We've got faith, but what about virtue? We could spend a whole sermon on doing those things. But the bottom line is, ask yourself the question, is this me? Are these works in me and abounding? Self-examination. Well, let's close. Paul, in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, talks about communion. And he talks about how that some people were eating and drinking the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. Okay? Now notice, he didn't say that the people were unworthy. We're all unworthy. Who of us are worthy in that sense? But the way they were eating was an unworthy manner. And he concludes that discussion with, everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread, and drink from the cup. It's Communion Sunday. The ushers are going to come, distribute the elements.
Yes.
As they're doing that, our job is to examine ourselves.
Yes, Lord.
And to make sure that we're eating and drinking in a worthy manner. Amen?
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
To your will and to your way. Yes, Lord.
And have the ushers please. On the night he was betrayed, the Lord took the bread and broke it. And he said, this is my body that's broken for you. I love you so much. I am going to take the horrible torture so that you can be forgiven.
Yes.
And enjoy.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
He said, this is my body that was broken for you. As often as you eat of it, do it in remembrance of me. Heavenly Father, as we come before you, we thank you for what you did for us. Father, those of us who are here in the congregation today, Father, all of us were believers in Jesus. But Lord, you've called us to a time to examine ourselves. Lord, help us to be thankful, and Father, to realize that our right to the table came because of what you did, not what we do. We ask it in the name of the one who allowed his body to be broken for us. In the same way, he took the cup and he said, this is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me. Father, when we came to you and we believed in the gospel of Jesus, we made a covenant with you. And we said that if you would forgive our sins, we would follow your rules, and that we would live for you. And Father, it's been a wonderful covenant. But Lord, life happens. Time goes on, and we have a tendency to grow a little bit callous in our hearts. And so you gave us something to pull us back and to help us reflect. We want to say to you, Father, we made a covenant years ago, and we gave you all, and all has become a whole lot larger, but it's still all. Father, we ask that you would renew our covenant with you. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Nicole, we practice open communion. If you're a Christian, we want you to take it with us. Bless the bread. Father, the blessing on the bread we ask today is for full assurance of our salvation.
Yes,
in
amen.
Jesus' name,
hear our prayer.
Amen.
Hear the prayer.
Father, the blessing of our cup is the renewal of the covenant between you and us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand.
Yeah.
Amen. As you go this week, go that you've examined yourself. And go in the confidence of full assurance of your salvation. And with that full assurance of your salvation, go be a real Christian. Amen. 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 And go in peace.